Thank you very much, and thank you for the invitation to participate here and try to say something about the challenges which are facing the Nordic welfare model or models. We can have a lengthy discussion about how to define the Nordic model or whether there are many models. It's called sometimes the Nordic model, sometimes the Scandinavian model, sometimes the universal model, sometimes the social democratic model. I will not go into this, but of course we cannot discuss challenges without looking at the characteristics. When we are interested in the challenges, it's because there are some aims, some objectives we would like to achieve also in the future. We would like to maintain some properties, and perhaps the world is changing or we have different things affecting society, and therefore there are things to discuss. If you look at the Nordic countries, I think some of the main characteristics is that these are countries who have a very high income level. They are among the richest countries in the world. They have extended welfare states. That implies both the social safety net, which is universal, applies to basically everybody, and the transfers are in general relatively generous compared to other countries, but it also applies to what in a Nordic context usually is called welfare services, that is education, health care, and so on. And what is important here is that it's the implicit understanding that what the public sector or the welfare state provides would satisfy the needs of most people. So that should be decent, up-to-date standards, and if you have your needs met by the public sector, you don't have to look for private solutions. So it's not just some lower standard residual you'll have to accept if you cannot afford anything else. So the service side is as important of the Nordic model as is the social safety net. It's a tax-financed model. That's implied by a universal thing that it's there for everybody, and then we contribute via taxes. Very complicated. Basically, most tax revenue comes from the direct or indirect taxation of labor income. The tax burden is therefore high, roughly 50% of GDP. But of course, the point here is that you cannot just assess taxes without also looking at what they are financing. And a lot of the stuff they are financing are actually active in the sense of promoting employment and so on. So there's a very important interaction between these things. We have fairly egalitarian outcomes. You can measure that in various ways, and we can, of course, debate that. But if you look at income inequality, or if you look at poverty rates and so on, the Scandinavian or Nordic countries come out with very egalitarian outcomes. And it's important to stress this is not mainly due to redistribution via taxes and transfers. Of course, there is such redistribution, but the basis for the egalitarian outcome is actually created in the labor market by having high employment rates and a basis on which most people can find a job with a decent wage. And then on top of that, there's some redistribution. And yeah, I already said the high employment rates, and the model has, and it's also touched upon that, it has very strong support. I guess if you try to understand politics in the Nordic countries, it's often very difficult to explain to foreigners what is really the differences between the political parties, because it really comes down to very fine details, because they basically support this scheme. You can find some on the extremes, which might have some deviating views, but the core is really, they agree on most of the essentials here, and there's very strong support in the population, all sorts of surveys and so on. And also important in this context is the trust in institutions. There's a very high trust in institutions, which also implies that people trust that the taxes they pay are put to good use, so to speak. So these are some of the characteristics. This is just a short list, but some of them. So what are the challenges? Well, we have one challenge related to, challenges related to the labor market. One is maintaining a high employment rate. It's an objective in itself for social reasons, but it's actually also important to maintain the financial viability of the model. At the same time, we want an egalitarian outcome, equal opportunities in the labor market in respect both to find jobs and the wages which people can earn. And many elements here. Of course, the crisis is one. We see an increase in unemployment that challenges this. In particular, there's a risk that the crisis would translate into an increase in long-term unemployment, and of course, the employment rate would fall, and that would have consequences. And we have a more sort of structural challenge, namely ensuring that we can maintain the high employment rate and the egalitarian outcome, and the key to that is education. The Nordic countries have been very focused on education in the past, but of course there's always new demands popping up, and there's some problems in the educational sector I'll come back to. Just a very brief on the crisis here captured in terms of the unemployment rate, here from 2005 and up to recently. The dotted line is the OECD. The red curve here is Norway, not at least in terms of unemployment affected by the financial crisis. The blue one is Denmark, very low unemployment before the crisis, quite some increase, but despite the increase, still an unemployment rate below the OECD average. Finland and Sweden had slightly higher unemployment than the OECD average before the crisis and have, of course, experienced an increase in unemployment, but still is around the OECD average. So the short version of this is that the Nordics are also affected by the financial crisis, but relatively speaking to other OECD countries, we are in the, if it has any meaning to say, the soft end of the consequences of the crisis. So many other countries have much more severe problems than we have. But we also have problems, and of course if you look at the prospects, all forecasts and so on, they are pretty dim, and we seem to be facing a rather prolonged crisis here. That's important for many reasons. One is this I mentioned about the employment rate and the budget, the financial viability of the welfare system. When you have an extended welfare system which has very relatively generous transfers for those out of employment and it's tax financed, then obviously if the employment rate changes, it has a huge effect on the budget. Every time employment goes down, you lose tax revenue. And you lose a lot of tax revenue because taxes are high, and you have higher expenditures because you have more expenditures on social transfers, and because transfers are high, this is a strong effect. Here you see the budget effect measured in terms of how the budget in 1 year is affected by 1% change in private, in private employment here. So take Denmark, it's slightly above 0.7. That means that if the employment rate goes down by 3%, that would translate to a budget effect of a deficit of 2% of GDP. So a permanent reduction in employment would imply a budget deficit of 2%. So it's a very strong budget sensitivity. It has pros and cons. On the pro side, this is part of so-called automatic stabilizers. When there is a crisis, of course, this helps cushion the economy to a recession, because it stabilizes disposable income and the economy. So that's nice. The problem is if the crisis is not temporary, but more persistent, because then it kicks in and affects the budget. But if you only have business cycle fluctuations as up and down, of course it has a stabilizing function or provides insurance. But if you're permanently at a lower level, of course you get into trouble, and the financial viability of the model is at stake. The reason why I mention this is that if we look at past crises in the Nordic countries, which I try to illustrate by this chart over here, the Nordic countries were in deep crisis in the end of the 80s or early 90s, a little different for the different Nordic countries. Here the chart is sort of that year one is the first year of the crisis, and what you see here is the employment rate. And the basic message of this picture is that it was a very deep crisis. You cannot necessarily prevent that, but you see that it was very prolonged, very persistent crisis, and it took quite a number of years to get out of the crisis. So, and this persistence, of course, translated into very severe financial problems. So we have learned a lesson about 15 years ago on the consequences of this, and that's, of course, also very clear in the mindset of at least most politicians. They know that we have a system which has these built-in stabilizers, that's nice, but if it translates into something more persistent, it's also a problem due to the budget implications. So a major challenge in the Nordics today is to maintain a high employment rate. One important element in the Nordics is the use of active labor market policies. We have the generous transfers and we have the high taxes, so that implies that for many the economic gain from finding a job is relatively small. How can you maintain a high employment rate in this situation? Well, the other side of this is active labor market policy, which is really putting in a lot of conditions. You cannot just passively claim benefits. You have to look for jobs, you have to document your search for a job, you have to participate in programs, you have to participate in educational programs if there's a barrier in terms of your qualifications and so on. Long list of programs, very intensive, which is to balance the economic incentives with the high employment rate. As you can see from the high employment rates, but of course when unemployment goes up, the system is challenged. You have a larger inflow, it would be more expensive just to run the programs, but also it might be more difficult to have well-designed programs when unemployment is high. Can you find the right programs? Can you put people in private job training? What kind of education programs should you put them into? So can you maintain the efficiency of this? And if not, then of course the balance in the system might be at stake. So that's a very important issue right now, due to the crisis, how to maintain this system, or the efficiency of the system. Then we have the education, and just a few words on this. As I already said, it's very important for employment, it's very important for equality as well, and it is in the model that education is basically publicly financed via taxes, so it's free when you get the education, and the implicit understanding or contract is that once you got the education, you enter the labor market, you earn an income, and then you pay taxes. And there's a lot of good things to be said about this system in terms of increasing the educational level, equal opportunities, social balance, and so on. What we see in the Nordics is that this system is challenged both in the quantitative and in the qualitative dimension. Even though education is free, we see large groups who do not really get education which gives them any qualifications relevant for the labor market. For instance, in my own country, 1/5 of a generation does not get an education which gives them any labor market relevant qualification. That's a huge number given that education is free and given the strong ambitions we have in respect to what people should be able to attain in the labor market. We also have substantial delays. Our young people enter the education system late and they stay on in the system rather late. So we have in Danish or in Nordic universities, you have the older students in the whole OECD area. And that's of course very important from a social perspective because we invest in human capital because it should be used in the labor market. So if we have too much delay there, the social returns to this is going down. So that's one part of it. The other is the qualitative dimension. At least the self-perception in the Nordics was earlier that we were among the best educated populations in the OECD area. I think that is fairly correct 30 years ago, about a generation ago, but it's no longer correct. That applies both to the share getting education at different levels, but also applies to the level of or the quality of the education. Various analyses have documented this. Perhaps Finland is an outlier here, but the other countries are in this position. And recent empirical work shows that the qualitative level of education is extremely important. Obviously for human capital, but also for productivity increases and so on. So that's really a major challenge to maintain this. Okay, to another one of the aspects or challenges related to the financial viability of the model is sort of in a more medium term perspective, we have the demographics, the aging, which is often highlighted as an important challenge. I agree it is, but yet it's something you can solve within the model. Of course, it might be politically difficult, but technically it's easy. You can make a pension reform, you can have later retirement, that will solve the problem. And the Nordic countries have done that. Perhaps not fully, but they have been far on that. What much more important is on the welfare side, the service side. As I said, they are tax finance, and what is provided by the public sector should meet the standards of most. And these standards are, of course, changing over time, because when there's development in society and we can do other things or new things, then we also expect that what is offered from the public sector follows this trend. Health is the particular challenge because, luckily, what is feasible in terms of treatment and so on in terms of health is improving all the time. And on top of this, some services, not all, but some services, they suffer from what is called the bubble disease, namely that it's very difficult to increase productivity, but services for which you cannot increase productivity, they tend to be more expensive over time. and then you have a problem because they should be financed by tax revenue, and that's not so easy. So there is a tension here between, on the one hand, what you can finance from taxes. I here put the tax burden to be roughly unchanged. We can, of course, discuss whether we can increase taxes in the Nordics, but it is relatively high. You have barriers set by globalization and incentive structure and so on. So I guess few would think that we can increase taxes significantly. And then we have these increasing demands. And how would you close this gap? Because it is in the model, and it's important for the model that for the individual there's no relationship between what I pay and my eligibility. That's the universal principle. So that has a lot of good things to be said for it. But of course, it also implies that there's no relation for the individual between my contribution to financing and what I get in return. But of course, this has to be met at the aggregate level. And how can we then control it? It's a political issue. Politicians have to control this. And that's not so easy. And even if you have tough politicians who can do it, you still end up with the problem that the people feel that they should have different standards than what they actually can get when they turn up at hospitals or schools or universities or whatever. Just one example, I already mentioned health. Here you can see forecasts going forward from 2005 to 2050 of the health expenditures. And most of this increase is driven by the need to meet the possibilities of new standards within health. And these are tremendous increases, because if you should increase health expenditures by 3-4 percentage points of GDP, you should either increase taxes, increase in tax burden of 3-4% of GDP, or you should find savings other places. It's not so easy. So a very difficult discussion here. Can we close some of this gap by productivity increases in the public sector? Or should we have some user payments? Should we introduce some linkage between what you pay and what you can get? Or should we reduce or shrink the packets such that the packets focus on fewer elements but make sure that these elements are then at a high standard? And these are some of the things being discussed, and these are really very difficult. There's not a simple technical solution to this, like later retirement, because this is deep into the model. Finally, a few words on globalization. The Nordics are small and open economies, so the globalization is not really a new agenda in the Nordic countries. There's a long tradition of being focused on this. There's a long tradition in the labor market understanding the room for wage increases and what happens if you're too aggressive because you lose competitiveness and so on. So many of these things are well known. Of course, some of these things are intensified, trade side, intensified competition, intensified skill bias, and so on. The tax system is under pressure. Some taxes are difficult to maintain at a high level because the tax base can shift, and then you have a discussion whether it can shift some taxes over to so-called immobile tax bases. And finally, there's migration. And migration is a difficult issue for the Nordic model, due to the way the model is constructed, the ambitions we have with respect to labor market policy and social policies. Because it is inherent in the model that we want a high employment rate, we expect all to participate in the labor market, males and females, and this is both for social reasons, social inclusion, but it's also for financial reasons, as I explained earlier. So we have this triangle or nexus, that we have the wages, we have the qualifications, and we have the, also misspelling here, social safety net. So if you have a general social safety net, of course, wages are high. How can you maintain high employment? You can only maintain high employment if qualifications are also at a high level. So you, so to speak, can deserve the high wage. That's embedded in all what I said about education, and historically been a lot of focus on this. Make sure that you have few with low qualifications such they are trapped in this situation. And those who are at risk of being trapped, try to help them with education. So that's a very important part of the element. But of course, if you have immigrants who come from low income countries and they have low qualifications, they are easily trapped in this system because they don't have the qualifications. So even though they would like to work, they can't find a job because they are not worth the minimum wage. The minimum wages in the Nordic countries are relatively high. They're actually negotiated in. And if they don't find a job, well, you have a social problem and you have an economic problem. And if you look at the Nordic countries, you can see that the gap in employment rate between immigrants from low-income countries and the native population is much larger in the Nordic countries than elsewhere. And it's not because the level of the employment rate for immigrants is lower, but it's because our ambitions is much higher. We expect a much higher employment rate for all groups, immigrants included. And of course, when we do not succeed in this, tensions arise. There's a financial problem of it, but there's also a social problem of it. And it's also a difficult problem because it's a core element of the model which is affected by migration. It works nicely if you have a reasonably closed economy in the sense that you have control over your population, but once people start to move, that can challenge the model. So to conclude, the Nordics are affected by the crisis, and it's serious business, but still in a comparative perspective, not as severely as most other countries. Perhaps worth stressing here that public finances, although there are deficits and so on, they are basically under control. Public debt levels are not very high, and fiscal sustainability and so on is basically ensured. We have in the Nordics seen reforms, pension reform, labor market reforms and so on. I think in comparative perspective one can say the Nordics are reasonably well at doing these reforms. Of course there are some delays, but eventually we get these reforms, and there's also clear political understanding that if you don't undertake these reforms, you might risk the whole system. But as I tried to explain briefly, that we still have some substantial challenges in the labor market, maintaining high employment, maintaining the egalitarian outcome, the education system, health, and migration. So thank you.